Okay, all right. So quantum mechanics, Schrodinger's cat, etc. So Schrodinger's cat, this is a cat, it's in a box. In this box, there is a beaker or a bottle, and it contains a capsule of cyanide. How do I spell cyanide? Cyanide. Okay. Now, for those of you who might not know, cyanide is a very fast-acting poison. In movies, you will see secret agents and other such people. They keep a cyanide capsule inside their teeth or somewhere so that if they are caught, they can bite into it and go away. So this experiment, you can imagine, is quite dark, a little bit of a disturbing thing. But I didn't come up with this experiment, okay? Schrodinger did, and he's famous. He got a Nobel Prize. So, you know, don't file any petitions in PETA or anything like that against me. So you have this cyanide vial, okay? And as you can imagine, the purpose of this cyanide vial is that it can fall down, right? It can fall down and break. And when it breaks, what will happen is that the cyanide will be released into the box. And when the cyanide is released, what will happen? The poor cat will die. This is a dead cat, right? Good enough. Now, where does quantum mechanics come into this picture? Now, what we need another piece of equipment, okay? That piece of equipment is called a beam splitter. So what is a beam splitter? A beam splitter is basically a mirror. So you are familiar with mirrors. How do you make a mirror? You take a piece of glass and you coat one side of the glass with aluminum or some metallic covering. So normally the mirrors that you see, they are 100% coated. So all the light that goes in comes back out. So a beam splitter is a mirror in which the coating, this is the coating, is only 50%. And so what can happen in a beam splitter is that if I send a beam of light into this mirror, this beam of light will be split into two parts. One part will reflect off the mirror as usual and go down, but then another part will be transmitted through the mirror. All right. Now, we are going to be talking about quantum mechanics. So in quantum mechanics, what can happen is, instead of sending in a beam of light, what we will be doing is, we will be sending in a single photon. Okay? Now, all of you have heard of photons, and you've all taken the introductory physics. So you know that a photon is a particle of light. So photon, a single photon goes. Now, since it's a single particle, instead of a beam, you might imagine that, well, a single particle can only do two possible things. It can either go through the mirror or it can bounce off, right? So there are two possibilities. One possibility is it is reflected. And the other possibility is that it's transmitted. These are the two possibilities, right? So I'll refer to this possibility reflected using this notation, which will become clear to you as time goes on. So we are using these angular brackets. So it looks like this. Straight line and then angular bracket like this. This is called what is known as a ket. Okay? Then later on we will be using their mirror companion. Okay? This is known as a bra. Okay, again, I didn't come up with these terms. So now the reason for this terminology is that if you look at it together, well, this is what is known as a bracket, right? So the physicists who first developed this, they were not very innovative. They just put a red line, divided this, and said, okay, well, this is the, we'll call this a bra and we'll call this a kit. Okay? Maybe at some point in the future, there will be like a big meeting and people will decide that let's come up with some better names for these things. Until then, unfortunately, we have to use these names only. So we have this possibility. Now we are associating these bras and these kits. We are associating them with possibilities, right? So in this case, the possibility is that a photon can either be reflected, so that is this possibility R, or it can be transmitted, that is this possibility T. Okay? So normally your intuition that you are used in daily life will tell you that either the photon can be transmitted, either, or it can be reflected, right? This is the what is possible, right? Either or, that's it, right? I mean, you can't have a situation where it's both transmitted and reflected, right? That is not, doesn't make sense, right? So for example, if I ask, is one of you, are you present in this meeting, right? And I say, what are the possibilities? Present, right? Or the other possibility is not present. Right? And so you'll say, well, okay, either a person can be present or they can not be present. Right? You're like, well, I mean, that's it, right? But now here's where quantum mechanics becomes fun. Because what quantum mechanics tells us, so this either or picture is what we associate with classical mechanics. What quantum mechanics tells us is that one can have R and T at the same time. This is what we get from quantum mechanics. This fact is what makes quantum mechanics different from classical mechanics. Everything comes out of this fact. So, in other words, another example is, let's say that you have a person and that person has a coin. Okay, so this coin has two faces. Okay, one is the head and the other is the tail. Now you ask the person to toss the coin, and when they toss the coin, it comes back, right? You catch it. So I have a coin here and I can toss it. Okay, what do you say? You say heads or tails, right? You say heads or tails. And what happens? I look at it, right? Until I look at it, I don't know, because I've tossed it and it's spinning around, but I don't know what it is. So I look at it and I find that it's tails. I can toss it again, and I find that again it's tails. And this time I get heads. Right? So each time what happened was I was getting the first time I got, okay, one second. The first time I got tails, second time I got tails, and the third time I got heads, right? you wouldn't say that I got tails and heads, right? That wouldn't make sense, at least according to our classical thinking. What quantum mechanics tells us is that that is not correct. What quantum mechanics says is, when I toss this coin, okay, and now it's a quantum coin, and I toss this coin and I have caught it, but I haven't looked at it, okay? When I haven't looked at it, what quantum mechanics says is, I cannot say whether it is in heads or whether it's in tails, right? Right? So your classical picture says that even if you haven't looked at it, right? If you imagine that you have a computer and there is a video camera that is capturing the motion of this coin as it is being tossed, right? And it is capturing the motion of this coin, and then it is calculating the trajectory of the coin, exact trajectory. And then it, you know, captures that entire information. Then you can determine what the state is going to be, right? Even without looking at it, right? And even if you cannot capture all that information, you still have this sense that no, it must be either in heads or tails, right? It can't be in both. It doesn't make sense. But quantum mechanics says that no. Until you look at this coin, you don't know what the state of the coin is. Okay? So the state of the coin is something that can either be tails or heads, but it can also be something in between. Okay? So how does that work? Now all of you have studied vectors, right? Everybody has studied vectors. So you know that in vector analysis, what do you have? So let's say we have a two-dimensional vector space like this. So let's say x hat and y hat, right? Now let me take any vector in a vector space, v. How do I write down v? I say v is equal to some a times x hat plus b times y hat, right? This is just what the definition of a vector is, right? Now, if it so happens that my vector is completely in the x direction, then what is the y component of the vector? It's going to be zero, right? Same way, if it's completely in the y direction, the x component will be zero. But in general, these coefficients, a and b, are not zero, right? Okay, now when you have a vector, you can also find the length of this vector, right? What is the length of the vector? A square plus b square, right? We'll be using this later. So, and these notes that I'm making, I'll be sharing them with you all after the class also, okay? You can use them as a reference. So when I look at what a vector means, it has a certain physical meaning, right? What is the physical meaning? It means that if I take this vector and I say, what is the x component of this vector? Means how much of x is in there, right? How much of x is in there? I take v and I take the dot product with x, right? This is called taking the projection of a vector. And I hope, every one of you should know what these things are, right? This is all very basic mathematics. high school mathematics. Similarly, if I take the projection of this vector onto y, I will get b. Right? Now imagine that, let's say that you have two different colors. Okay? You have a color which is red and a color which is blue. Okay? And so let's say you are making some paint. Let's say you have a third color. So you have three colors, red, blue, and green. And let's represent red, blue, and green by three different vectors, unit vectors, RBG. Okay? Now let's write down a vector. So what is this? This is basically a three-dimensional vector space, which is written using this notation, R3. R is a set of real numbers. So let me, instead of, instead of A, B, C, I'll use something else. I'll use L times R hat, M times B hat, N times G hat. Okay, L, M, N, these are the components. So how, what does this mean, L, M, N? Let's say that L is equal to 1 and M is equal to 0 and N is equal to 0. Right? Then what does the vector represent? It represents the color red, pure red. Right? So if you're mixing paint, this would be the situation in which it is 100% red. Let's say L is equal to 0.5, M is equal to 0.5, N is equal to 0. This represents a situation in which your color is half red and half blue. Right? You're mixing paint, you put 50% red and 50% blue. Right? If you can't hear me for any reason, let me know, okay? Because my internet connection is saying is there some issue. Right? So that is what these components mean. They tell you how much of that property is there in this vector. Okay? So now I'm going to do something which will seem crazy. Now, what I did in the last slide was I took these possibilities, right? I said a photon can be reflected or transmitted, right? And then I took this coin and I said it can have either heads or tails. So what I'm going to say is I'm going to write down a vector. Okay? And this vector has, so what is this RBG, what are these also known as in vectors? This is known as a basis, right? These are your basis vectors. Okay, so some basis elements. So I'm going to write down a vector. Let's say A times heads plus B times tails. Right. So now remember earlier we said that in classical mechanics you can have either heads or tails. Right? But when I write down a vector of this form, what does it tell me? It tells me that this is a combination of heads and tails, right? What do we call such a combination? It's called a superposition. Okay? Now, the idea of a superposition is something that you have seen before. So for instance, when you talk about electric fields, for instance, electric field strength. Okay. And you say, what is the electric field at a certain point in space? Well, you say that the electric field is a sum of let's say that there are n different point sources, let's say q1, q2, qn, and you are asking what is the electric field at a certain point in space. This is my point xyz, right? So the electric field at this point is going to be, so there is some contribution from E1, some contribution from the second charge E2, and some contribution from EN, and so on. And so the total electric field at this point, whatever that total electric field is, let's say it is this. This is going to be the sum of these vectors, right? And this kind of a sum is called a superposition, right? So in this case, you don't have any issues with the electric field going either in this direction or in that direction. You understand, it's a vector. It has a component in this direction and a component in this direction and a component in this direction. And it has all three components at the same time, right? So when we look at a vector of this form, right? If you forget about the fact that this stands for heads and this stands for tails, and you just think of them as two basis vectors, then this is just telling you that, well, I have a vector. It has a certain component in the heads direction and a certain component in the tails direction. Okay. Now, this is the great thing, okay? Is that this vector that I have written down, I'm going to write it like this now. This is the Greek letter psi. Okay? So psi is equal to A times heads plus B times tails. And I'm going to tell you that what is this psi? It represents the state of my coin. Okay? That means that until I measure the coin, okay? Until I actually look at what's in my hands, I don't know whether the coin is either in heads or in tails. Okay? What I can do is I can write down the state of the coin. Right? Now, what are the basic possibilities? The elementary possibilities? In this case, there are only two elementary possibilities. One is heads and one is tails. So the state of my coin can be a linear superposition of these possibilities. Okay? Now, when I look at the coin, what happens? I find that it is either in heads or in tails, right? I don't find that it is in a mixture, right? That's not how my brain registers it. My brain registers it as heads or tails. So what happens? How can I take this vector, right? How can I take this vector and convert it into a single heads or a single tails? Right? The answer is very simple. I'll just take the component of the vector in the heads direction. So what will I do? Remember that when I wanted to find this when I wanted to find the x component, what did I do? I just took the vector and took the dot product with x, right? That gave me the component in the x direction. So if I want to find out, well, how much of heads is in there, what do? I take the dot product of psi with the heads vector, okay? Now, again, I'm going to introduce some more notation. How do I do that? I do it like this. Now, so far we have been using ket vectors, okay? Now I'm going to use a bra vector. So I take the bra vector and I write this expression. Now you are familiar with the fact that if you have any two vectors u and v, you can take the dot product and you can write the dot product in this way, right? But in quantum mechanics, we have two different kinds of vectors. We have bra vectors and ket vectors. In what the kind of vector spaces you have studied up till now, you only have one kind of vector. So here, when we take the dot product of two vectors, what do? If you have a vector v, then let's say it's a ket vector, and we have another vector u, that's also a ket vector. And I want to take the dot product of these two vectors. How do I do that? I take this ket vector and turn it into a bra vector. Okay? And actually, what is this operation? This, again, all of these things will be clarified later in much more detail. This operation is basically nothing but complex conjugation. Okay? So these vectors that we use in quantum mechanics, these are all complex vectors. A and B, these are all complex numbers. Okay? So I take the complex conjugate of my vector, and then I make the dot product between this bra vector and this ket vector. That is my, this is the equivalent of saying u dot v. Only thing is that instead of u dot v, what this actually means is u complex conjugate dotted with v. Okay? So if I have u dot v, how do I write this? I say ui vi. Sum of I from 1 to n, where n is the number of components, right? Here I have u conjugate dotted with v. In terms of components, what will it be? It will be sum of I is equal to 1 to n u of I complex conjugate times v of I. Okay, so now when you're talking about these vectors, these complex vectors, if I take u dot v, it looks like this, but I can also take v dot u, right? And what is v dot u? V dot u is going to be the same thing, but now it's going to be vi complex conjugate times ui. Right? So from the rules of complex conjugation, what do I know? That if I have a complex number, which is the product of two other complex numbers, let's say z1 and z2, right? Then if I take the complex conjugate of this number, what is it going to be equal to? It's going to be the complex conjugate of these two numbers. So if I take ui complex conjugate and vi, what is the complex conjugate of this whole thing? complex conjugate is UI VI complex conjugate, right? And the second thing I know is that if I have a complex number, okay, Aditya, sorry for running over time. Yeah, sure, you can leave. I'll just wrap up in 2 more minutes, okay? You can leave if you want. If I take the complex conjugate of Z, it's the sum of the complex conjugate of both all these numbers. So if you apply these rules, right, you see that V dot U is equal to U dot V whole complex conjugate. Right? Okay. So we'll continue tomorrow. So for now, I've sort of left you hanging, but hopefully this will provide motivation for you to attend tomorrow's class. So we have a state psi, and it's a superposition of two possibilities. Tomorrow we'll talk about how, when you make a measurement, instead of being a superposition, the state collapses. So the word, technical word, is collapse. The state collapses into one of those possibilities, either heads or tails. All right. Are there any questions at this point? You can either raise your hand, just unmute yourself and ask a question, whatever your question is, if you have any questions. Okay. No questions? Okay. Utsav is asking the most relative question, which is important question. What will be the test mode? Okay, so if there are no questions, I'll stop the recording, okay?